Give the doctors and and bring healing to them and be with their families. Lord, would you pray for President Biden as well? And we pray that, God, you would, Lord, bring him to salvation, Lord. We pray that, God, you would work in our leaders' hearts, whether they're federal, state, or local, that, God, you would, first of all, bring them to a personal relationship with you. But then, secondarily, Lord, we pray for wisdom. Lord, your word commands that we pray for those in authority over us. Lord, and if we're derelict in that duty, Lord, it's our own fault that we end up with what we have because we haven't prayed. So, God, help us in that. Lord, be with our leaders. Lord, we pray that today would be a great day as we worship you. We thank you for bringing Brother Lars Carlson from Youth Haven. God, what a mighty work you're doing out there in this place, in Michigan and Arizona. I know there's a couple campuses, Lord, and you're doing an amazing work through them and the volunteers and the staff that are there. And we just look forward to worshiping you this morning and hearing the message that you laid on Brother Lars' heart. And then we look forward to hearing an update on what's going on at Youth Haven. And Lord, we pray that, God, we would only be just affected in our eyes, Lord, and in our ears, but Lord, we would be affected in our heart this morning. And God, we would walk away from this place in greater unison with you and with one another, and equipped to go out into this world and be the salt and light you've called us to be. We ask these things in your precious name. Amen.
All right. We're going to go ahead and sing Soon and Very Soon.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Amen. Good singing this morning. These are some of my favorite songs. What a day that'll be. Huh? Yeah, I know it's a hymn, isn't it?
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be.
commencement. The last chorus, one more time. Ready?
What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Amen. Good singing this morning. Everybody can be seated. At this time, the pastor and Lori are going to sing, and this song that they're singing is our new song for next month. So, I'm kind of excited about that.
Here's the power.
Thank you for that message. The cross, that's what it's all about.
Amen.
And we have so much to rejoice in and be grateful for and take confidence in and have hope in the cross.
Amen.
Well, let me just first say thank you for the invitation to be here today. It's nice to be back. We've loved the partnership that Liberty has had, and many of you have chosen to engage with Youth Haven through the years. I would be remiss if I didn't acknowledge the fact that I miss one special person today, and that's Betty.
Amen.
A saint home with the Lord, and Jerry and Betty reunited with their Lord and Savior. A great couple that just served at Youth Haven for so many years.
Amen.
And so we are very saddened here on earth, but that hope that we have in the cross, she's experiencing today, and we wouldn't want her back.
Amen.
But it is a reality that her presence is definitely missed today as I come and share. Let me open in prayer, and then love to dig into God's Word together. Heavenly Father, I just thank you this morning for that hope that we have in the cross. That in moments in our lives and as a country, Lord, that we can turn to you and know of your power and strength and might. And Lord, I just pray this morning that as we open your Word together, that you would speak through me, and that you would remind us of that you are in control and that your power and might is so unfathomable. So Lord, I just pray that you would bless this time. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
Well, it's great to again be back with you and to just spend a few minutes together looking at some things that God has laid on my heart. As we go through this situation in our country in the last 16 hours or so, and so many things that led up to it, and just the realities of our world, the fallen world we live in, I think there's such strength to be found in God's Word. And so this morning, I want to take some time to do that. On June 14th, 2015, a team of Chinese astronomers using an apparatus, and I want to read this, the All-Sky Automated Survey for Supernova, stationed in Cerro Tololo, Chile, discovered a powerful stellar explosion. I don't know if any of you remember hearing about this, but what they believe to be a supernova, it became known as ASASSN 15LH. That's their designation for it. But this explosion occurred 3.8 billion years, light years, from Earth. And it's both baffled and amazed astronomers. They're not sure if it's a supernova, a star that just literally exploded like many they've seen in the universe, or if potentially this is a star that was sucked into a black hole and as a result was ripped apart and became this massive explosion. I want to show you a picture of the event. I don't know if we can... There we go. The numbers used to articulate this light, or the light of this exploding star, are beyond our comprehension. So if you remember scientific notation, I'm not a math guy, so I'll just tell you. For me, scientific notation, I learned it, but 10 to the second power is 100. 10 to the fourth power is 10,000. Well, this explosion produced the light of 10 to the 38th power watts.
Wow.
Folks, that's 100 billion, 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 billion watts. That's a lot of light. So this supernova was about 580 billion times brighter than our sun. Incomprehensible. Hmm. And then there's the energy it produced. The explosion radiated every second as much power as the sun would produce over 18,000 years. Or think of it this way, for its few dying days, this exploding star was nearly 30 times more luminous than our entire Milky Way galaxy of over 100 billion stars. In a single nanosecond, this explosion expelled more energy than all the power plants on Earth could produce, operating at full capacity for 2.8 billion years. You get the picture. This explosion is literally beyond our comprehension.
Yeah.
And this unbelievable astronomical event occurred in one small section of the sky next to one single galaxy. Just think of the number of galaxies that are in existence. I want to show you a second image here. This is known as the Deep Star Field. This image was created by combining many images that the Hubble telescope took over the past decade. All of the individual images were taken in a small patch of sky near the constellation Fornax, which is actually in the southern hemisphere, a 1/30 millionth of the night sky. And all of these images were put together with over 2 million seconds of exposure time. It's the deepest image of the universe ever created. Combining data from 2002, 2003, 2009, and it, again, 1/30 millionth of the night sky. Yet even in this tiny fraction of the night sky, we see over 5,500 galaxies.
Mm. Wow.
Those are not stars. Those are galaxies in that image. 1/30 millionth of the sky. Brothers and sisters, this morning I'm here to tell you we serve a powerful, powerful,
amen.
And
that's right.
Amazing God. Amen. A God who, when Moses stood in front of him in the burning bush and said, "Who should I say that you are?" God responded with, "Tell them I am." He is. He's awesome. He's the great I am. Truly the only one that deserves those names.
Yes. Praise.
And he's a God that not only demonstrates his power for us through his imagery above us in the night sky and around us here on earth, but he wants to show his power through us. And there are so many examples in Scripture that we see where he has done that. And I'm sure many of you, if we were to take time this morning, could stand up and share a story or an example of how God has demonstrated his power in your life, but even used you to demonstrate his power to others. And that's what I want to look at this morning as we spend a few minutes together, is a prime example of a character in the Bible who I think there's no greater example of how God worked through him, and that's the prophet Elijah. I think he truly demonstrates and models what it means to be courageous and a fully devoted follower of the Lord. Not perfect. There are certainly times in his life where he messed up and lost sight of the reality of the fact that God was in control. But there's so much about his life that I think we can learn from. And so this morning, if you want to take your Bible and turn with me to 1 Kings 17, I think there's four principles that we can learn from his experience as we wrestle with how to respond to our world and trust in God. And I think this morning as we, you know, reflect on what's taken place over the last 16 hours again, especially, there is so much of a need for us to refocus. Mm-hmm. I know I've been glued to the television and I've just been watching and kind of observing some of the happenings of this experience. And you know what? The birds are out flying in the air and they don't care. God's meeting their needs. He's providing for them and mm-hmm. cares for them. How much more does he care for us? So just a little backstory as we look into God's word. After the death of King Solomon, Israel and Judah had been under some truly wicked kings, some pretty, pretty bad dudes, including Ahab, which the Bible said did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than all of the kings of Israel who were before him. You don't really want that on your tombstone as an epitaph. One of his main abominations was encouraging the worship of the false god Baal. And Israel, of course, dealt with this throughout their existence, continuously turning to false gods, which, you know, my wife and I have been going through the chronological Bible, and we've read through all of the passages related to just how Israel, you know, God's shown his power on the mountain. And yet they're turning to a golden calf. I mean, and we look at that and we think, how could they? But how many of us in our lives have seen God's power, seen his might, seen the imagery above us, or looked at the heavens and the earth and understood his power, but then turned to the golden calves in our life? In 1 Kings 17:1, we read how God sends Elijah to tell Ahab that there's going to be a terrible drought throughout the land, which I'm sure the king was not very happy to hear, and no doubt wanted to take that vengeance out on Elijah for being the messenger. In fact, Ahab even refers to Elijah as the troubler of Israel later on. But Elijah did what God asked. He took the steps necessary to follow God's direction in his life. And I think that's principle number one, is that for us to see God's power working through us, we must be willing. And that's a reality that's hard to come to terms with sometimes. The things that God might be asking us to do, and yet we're not necessarily willing to do it. Because of fear, maybe we're afraid of a relationship that might get broken, or maybe there's the reality of the fear of, you know, persecution. We see that so much in our country more than ever against Christians. But we must be willing for God to be able to do what he wants to through us. So after this encounter with Ahab, God sends Elijah into hiding to the east, where while there, God works a miracle for the prophet. He brings sustenance. He brings ravens that feed him morning and night. Can you imagine sitting by a brook and all of a sudden birds are flying in and bringing food to you? I can only imagine the first time that happened, what Elijah must have thought as he saw this bird landing and bringing food to him. But God met his need. God sustained him in the midst of Elijah's need to protect him. And then God sends Elijah to the house of a widow and her son. And because of the drought, this family, they were struggling to even survive. They had no food. And yet God performed another miracle for the prophet and this widow and her son and provided food for them and was able to sustain all three of them for several years. And finally, during the few years that Elijah is with this widow and her son becomes very, very ill and eventually dies. And God performs another miracle through the prophet. After this young man dies, we begin to really understand Elijah's faith. And also we can see God's love, power, as he works this miracle. So I'm going to read from 1 Kings 17, 19 through 22. And he said to her, "Give me your son." And he took him from her arms and carried him up into the upper chamber where he lodged and laid on him his own bed. And he cried to the Lord, "O Lord my God, have you brought calamity upon this widow with whom I sojourn by killing her son?" Then he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried to the Lord, "O Lord my God, let this child's life come into him again." And the Lord listened to the voice of Elijah, and the life of the child came into him again, and he revived. Wow. Now, if Elijah's story kind of ended there, you know, with those three miracles, the birds and being taken care of with animals that were bringing food to him, the provision of food for many years that God provided to him and this widow and her son, and then to be able to be used by the Lord to revive this young man back to life, we think, man, his story was unbelievable. That's enough. But God has more on tap for Elijah. He's got more to do. And this is where it really gets exciting, where God really begins to use Elijah across the land. So God tells Elijah after this experience to go back to Ahab, which I can only imagine after being in hiding, he was very fearful to do, and to have them meet for a showdown with the... He wanted Ahab to bring all of his prophets of Baal and to have them meet for a showdown on Mount Carmel. And this is one man against many. In fact, if you read in 1 Kings 18, here's what Elijah says as he's standing in front of all these men, recognizing he's only one. He says, I only, am left the prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets are 450 men. You talk about faith. To stand in the midst of 450 men and all these other people around, and he's one, and yet he knows that God has a plan, and it's up to him to respond, to go, and he must be willing. Now, he's alone in this fight in the world's eyes, but he knows with God on his side, nothing can stand against him. And so I think that's another principle that we must have, that we must have faith in God's plan. And that's hard to do sometimes. In our world, in our lives, it's hard to recognize that God has a bigger purpose, and so we must trust him, no matter what it might mean, to be willing to go and to do what he's asked us to do, but yet to have that confidence that his plan is right. I can tell you when New Haven began back in 1968, my grandparents, Maury and Dorothy Carlson, they lived in Detroit. At the time, my grandpa had some businesses, and they were honestly quite successful from a worldly perspective down in Detroit, but they knew that there was more to do and that God had more for them. And so as they began to pray, Lord, what is it you have for us to do? God opened up the door in a little town called Rives Junction in the center of the state to begin a work called Youth Haven, and they left everything. My grandma, I remember her talking about how one of the hardest things she ever had to do in that time of her life was to sell her china cabinet and all of her china. And walk away from the comfortable lifestyle that they knew and to step into a dilapidated farm that God had provided, to move into a mobile home on a cement slab and to begin what God had for them. They were not perfect people. My grandparents were not perfect people. But they followed God's lead, and my grandpa was a man of faith like none. I have so many vivid memories of hearing him just talking about how he trusted God. And you know what? If God doesn't bring the resources to bring the kids, we won't bring the kids. It's his ministry, and I trust him. And I remember him saying things like that in my presence. Then that's what we have to have. That's what Elijah had. He had that faith that God was going to do something pretty awesome. So Elijah then calls on the Baal prophets to take their bull, prepare it on the altar, but not to put fire to it. So they do that. They go and they put their animal on this altar that they've created. And we'll pick up in 1 Kings 18:26. And they took the bull that was given them, and they prepared it, and called upon the name of Baal from morning until noon, saying, "O Baal, answer us." But there was no voice. No one answered. They limped around the altar that they had just made. And at noon, Elijah mocked them. I think this is so funny, honestly. He'd cry aloud, for he is a god. Either he's musing, or he is relieving himself, or he is on a journey, or perhaps he is asleep and must be awakened. And they cried aloud and cut themselves after their custom with swords and lances until the blood gushed out upon them. As midday passed, they raved on until the time of the offering of the oblation, and there was no voice. No one answered. No one paid attention. I can only imagine what this scene really looked like. These guys had to be pretty strange. I mean, before this all started, I'm sure the prophets of Baal had a very odd look and just feel to them. But here they are, you know, just created this altar. They put this bowl that they've sacrificed on it, and they're dancing around. Nothing's happening. No response from anything. And Elijah's mocking them. What confidence.
You're right.
And I love this because it really shows the personality and as well just the trust and confidence that Elijah had in the Lord. And he had his human side. He was like us, folks. He was a created human that God made. Yet he demonstrated this confidence. Again, him, one person, against 450 prophets of Baal. With the king standing there, who I'm sure still wanted his life, given the fact that he had been the one that prophesied the drought was going to come. Just such an example at what this man had as far as faith. And then it's God's turn. Picking up in verse 30, "Then Elijah said to all the people, 'Come near to me.' And all the people came near to him. And he repaired the altar of the Lord that had been thrown down. Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the tribes of the son of Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord came, saying, 'Israel shall be your name.' And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord. And he made a trench about the altar, as great as would contain 2 seas of seed. And he put the wood in order and cut the bowl in pieces and laid it on the wood. And he said, 'Fill 4 jars with water and pour it on the burnt offering and on the wood.' He said, 'Do it a second time.' And they did it a second time. And he said, 'Do it a third time.' And they did it a third time. And the water ran around the altar and filled the trench also with water. And at the time of the offering of the oblation, Elijah the prophet came near and said, 'O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, that the people may know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have turned their hearts back.' Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt offering, and the wood, and the stones, and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, "The Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God." Amen. And Elijah said to them, "Seize the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape." And they seized them. And Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and slaughtered them there. Unbelievable to think of what that must have been like.
Right.
I keep saying that because it's just, it's a story that when you really stop and think of what they witnessed, the power, the might, the just indescribable, awesome example of who God is.
Amen.
Another principle here that I think we can learn from Elijah is that he was willing to pray to the Lord at his time of need. If you read his prayer, as he goes and he asks the Lord to provide this amazing spectacle of God's display of power, he did so in confidence that he turned to the Lord to bring honor and glory to the Lord alone. It would have been easy for Elijah to kind of sit there and say, look what I did, built this. No, not in any way, shape, or form. He gave glory 100% to the Lord.
That's right.
In his prayer and through this entire experience. The fourth principle is that we must have courage and confidence, just like Elijah demonstrated. God could have just wiped out the prophets of Baal. I mean, if God had truly wanted to just be done with them, he could have done that. Just like back in Egypt, God could have taken his people and just caused them to be able to leave without any need for the plagues or anything like that. No, God demonstrated his power through those moments, through those experiences. It's really neat. We've been going through that with the kids at New Haven. We've been teaching them about the Exodus and the reality of how God used those experiences to teach the people about his power. And so as all of the people of Israel are standing here observing this, once more, God is showing his power and his might to his people. And that was his purpose in this. But he used one man. One man, Elijah, to do that. Who through his obedience, his prayer, his faith, his courage, and his confidence, God was able to demonstrate his power. Brothers and sisters, we serve that God.
Amen.
He hasn't changed. We as a country, as a culture, as a world, we've changed in many ways. God has not changed. The God who spoke the earth, planets, stars, galaxies, the whole universe into existence. The God that created and breathed life into man. The God that parted the Red Sea. The God that gave power to kill a giant to a young boy. Mm-hmm. The God that closed the mouth of lions. The God that protected in the fiery furnace. The God that brought dry bones to life. The God that turned water into wine. The God who fed the 5,000. The God that walked on water. The God that calmed the storm. The God that healed the sick, gave sight to the blind, made the lame walk, and raised Lazarus from the dead, and the God that conquered death and rose from the grave. That is the God we serve this
Amen.
Morning. So I have to ask a question that I look in the mirror at times and I ask myself this question. Why do we fear? If the God that did all the things that we just articulated, and the God that brought that fire from heaven that literally ate up the entire altar and everything around it, and so many other great stories in scripture of God where he showed his power and he showed his might, if that's the God we're worshiping this morning here at Liberty Baptist Church on Sunday, June 14th, 2024, why do we fear? What is it that we do that lets the enemy win and turns our eyes away from that truth of God's power? God wants to demonstrate his power in our lives. God wants to demonstrate his power to this world through us.
Yeah.
Do we have the faith, confidence, the courage, all the things that we can read about with Elijah to let him, to be used by him? Now, my dad has a saying that it was one he created, but he's used it for years, that God works with us, God works through us, like we're talking about this morning, and God works in spite of us. Yep. I'm glad he does, because there's many a time that I'm glad God works in spite of my shortcomings. But God wants to demonstrate his power in us and through us.
Amen.
And I believe that we have that ability if we just let him. If we just invite him to do that and we show the faith and the confidence that we read about in Elijah's life. I don't know what struggles you may be facing this morning. For some of you, maybe it's a financial issue. Our economy's tough right now. We feel that at Youth Haven. It's just a reality. I feel that in my own life. I mean, you go to the grocery store, it's unbelievable what stuff costs nowadays. So I'm sure that for some of you, finances are extremely tight, and maybe that's the struggle you're facing. Maybe it's a health issue. Something you're dealing with as a health issue. Just a quick story, just to bring it to light. For me, I've had that moment. I had a moment 2015 that all of a sudden I'm shaving one morning, I felt a bump, and short story is after many tests, I was diagnosed with lymphoma. Out of the blue, 2016. Interestingly enough, January 1st of 2016, my dad had said it was time to pass the baton of leadership at Youth Haven. The board of directors, our board, asked me to prayerfully consider receiving that, and so I did. I humbly accepted that on January 1, 2016, and on January 2nd, I was diagnosed with lymphoma. Now, I saw it for what it was, spiritual attack. Satan had his ways. He would have taken me out. So I immediately clung to Job's story. I am not Job. I only hope to be the man that Job was. But I clung to his story. I said, Lord, please don't take my life. I want to continue to serve you. I've got a young family. I want to do all I can to continue to serve you. I stand before you healed. I'm grateful for that.
Amen.
That truth. And this isn't a pat on my back at all. All glory to God.
That's right.
But I had a responsibility in that moment to say, am I going to respond and trust, or am I going to go my own way and say, Lord, how dare you? I actually had one of my friends sat in front of me and said, Lars, if you ever want to vent, when I was going through this, if you ever want to vent, you're just really frustrated, you let me know. I never felt that. I felt it. And then I had another friend that said, who's been dealing with some health issues, he said, Lars, in my life, I realized I can either push aside the one who can heal me, or draw closer to him.
Amen.
So I don't know what you're dealing with. Maybe that's a story you can relate to. Some of you, I absolutely know you've had some health battles that are way greater than anything I've dealt with. But God is our healer. God is our provider. God is our strength. God is our rock. And maybe the thing this morning is everything we're seeing play out in the last 16 hours times 10. You know, our country is in a state like I can imagine how those who have gone before look at where we are right now and just the sadness, the reality of where we are, the way that we've turned God away in so many of our public areas. We see it again at Youth Haven. The kids that come to Youth Haven, most of them come from non-churched families. You know, they're not in Christian schools. They're in public education systems, and we see kids left and right coming that have a need for a ministry like Youth Haven to hear about Jesus. And I'm going to share about that here in a few minutes after we're done in the morning service, just about what God's doing through the ministry. But the need is increasing. We get applications constantly for help from people just reaching out for help. So maybe it's our culture that's a discouragement to you this morning, and a reality of just how do we deal with this? Let the truth we serve the same God Elijah served.
Amen.
Sink in this morning.
That's right.
And give you confidence this morning. And when those moments of fear come, and they come, I absolutely get it. When they come, to recognize that God is on the throne. And you can have confidence in him. Turn to his word. Turn to him. Just talk to him when you're in those moments where you need that extra boost of confidence and courage and wisdom, or whatever it is that you have. And if he calls you to do something, do it. It didn't work out very well for Jonah when he didn't. And I don't know what that might be. Maybe it's as simple as just praying for somebody in your life that he's prompted your heart, hey, stand in the gap for this person, and you haven't responded to that. Maybe it's actually going and talking to somebody, inviting them to church to come and be part of what God's doing here and to help draw them to him. Maybe it's something greater. I don't know what it might be. We all have those spirit-led nudgings. And our responsibility is to respond to what he's prompting us to do.
Amen.
I want to just kind of draw it together with a passage out of 1 Corinthians. It's actually one that I spoke on last time I was here. 1 Corinthians 15:57. Give me a minute to turn there as I take a minute to turn there too. I love the way Paul teaches and writes to the churches that he spoke to, and just the way that he brings so many things forward. But he says this in 57, "Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Our responsibility is, though, therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." We must stand firm. We must be steadfast in our confidence in who God is and who God has made us to be. So just a few final questions. Are you willing? Are you willing to follow God's leading in your life? And maybe that starts with a prayer of, Lord, is there some areas in my life that I haven't been willing to give to you or to do what you've asked me to do, even if it means being uncomfortable? Are you willing to speak truth and stand up for your belief in Christ in this world? You know, we for so many years have had, honestly, a pretty low amount of persecution in our country as it relates to being a Christian. That's not so much the case anymore. We feel the persecution, not to the degree that a lot of our brothers and sisters that have served overseas or in, you know, years gone by have experienced, but we see that. And that takes bravery, courage, strength, all the things we're talking about that we need to look to God to give us. Do we have that confidence and that strength to speak up and stand up for our beliefs in Christ Jesus? And third, do you have and demonstrate a confidence and faith that God will answer your prayers? What a blessing we have to be able to be in his presence at any point, at any time.
That's right.
When you really think about the fact that the God who spoke the universe into existence invites us, doesn't just open the door, but invites us to come into his presence and to enter into his throne room. Something that his children had to have priests do, and you know, and the Israelites, and we have that privilege. The veil's been torn. We can move into his presence as followers of Jesus. What a blessing we have to be able to do that. Elijah had confidence in God to answer his prayers and boldly entered into the throne room. We can see it time and time again. Boldly entering into the throne room of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hebrews 4:16 says, "Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Rest in that promise. Make prayer time something that is a regular part of your life.
Yes.
I want to just conclude and close this morning with a blessing from Paul found in Ephesians 4, starting in verse 14. "For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory he may grant you to be strengthened with the power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the height, and the depth, to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever."
Hey.
Let me pray. Father, I just thank you so much that you haven't changed. That even in the midst of circumstances in our lives or in our country, we can have confidence